Hello, it's Saturday the 30th of April. You're tuned in to our 6 p.m. newscast coming to you from Arirang's news centre in Seoul. It's very good to have you with us. I'm Mark Broome. The world's reaction to North Korea's latest provocations is our starting point this evening. Concerned with the regime's rapid firing of multiple ballistic missiles over the past couple of weeks, the UN Security Council has been working on a suitable response. It also wants to check on how strictly member nations are enforcing the current sanctions on North Korea. Lee Ji-won starts us off.
The UN Security Council convened on Friday to discuss ways to strengthen the enforcement of sanctions on North Korea after the regime attempted to test fire three mid-range ballistic missiles in the space of 2 weeks. According to AFP, the draft statement requests all UN member countries to submit a report on the concrete measures they have taken to impose sanctions on North Korea by May 31st. The statement also directs the UN Sanctions Committee to intensify its work in enforcing the current sanctions resolution on North Korea, which was implemented in March after Pyongyang's fourth nuclear test and long-range missile launch. The latest sanctions, which are the toughest to date, attempt to make it difficult for the North to raise funds to further develop its nuclear and missile programs, including ban on mineral exports from North Korea, the inspection of cargo, and more. The U.S. and China have agreed on the latest statement, but Russia has requested more time to consider it, delaying the adoption to later this weekend or next week. Meanwhile, South Korea's defense ministry said Friday that North Korea's recent missile launches won't be Pyongyang's last, given that the regime dared to test two more Musudan missiles after its previous failure. And with its first ruling Workers' Party Congress in 3.5 decades slated for Friday, Seoul believes North Korea wants to stack up some military accomplishments to cement the power base around Kim Jong-un. Lee Ji-won, Arirang News.
Now, North Korea is thought to be preparing to reprocess spent nuclear fuel to get more plutonium for nuclear weapons. Citing satellite imagery taken of the North's main nuclear complex earlier this week, the U.S.-based Institute for Science and International Security said North Korea was renovating its nuclear waste disposal facilities, possibly in anticipation of additional plutonium separation activities. The Yongbyon complex has been a focus of attention since U.S. intelligence Chief James Clapper said in February that the North had restarted its main nuclear reactor and has since run it for long enough to harvest plutonium for nuclear bombs. The reactor provided North Korea with the weapons-grade plutonium the regime used in its first three nuclear tests in 2006, 2009 and 2013. U.S. forces in Korea have a new commander. General Vincent Brooks had his inauguration earlier today as the two allies wrapped up their annual joint military exercises. Connie Kim reports.
Vincent Brooks, the new commander of U.S. Forces Korea, emphasized the increasingly strong alliance between Seoul and Washington during his inauguration ceremony on Saturday. Facing growing threats from North Korea, Brooks said Seoul and Washington must confront challenges to peace and prosperity. His inauguration came on the same day as the official ending of the annual South Korea-U.S. joint military drills. The two-month exercise that started in March was the largest ever, coming after North Korea's nuclear and long-range missile tests early this year. Some 300,000 South Korean troops and 17,000 American troops took part along with key U.S. strategic weaponry. Two U.S. amphibious assault ships were deployed to South Korea at the same time, and an operational plan that preemptively strikes key North Korean facilities was carried out for the first time. North Korea on Saturday slammed the exercises as the worst military provocation that led to the brink of war. In a statement released by its foreign ministry, North Korea warned its nuclear attack capabilities advance every time its enemies launch a nuclear war practice. The North calls the joint drills a rehearsal for war, but Seoul and Washington insist they are purely defensive in nature. Although the exercises have come to an end, tension on the Korean Peninsula remains high as North Korea is speculated to conduct its fifth nuclear test ahead of its ruling Workers' Party Congress next week. Connie Kim, Arirang News.
The United States says the potential deployment of a U.S. missile defense system to South Korea should not affect China's willingness to pressure North Korea. White House Press Secretary Josh Earnest says the Terminal High Altitude Area Defense, or THAAD, missile defense system would be aimed at countering the threat in North Korea, not China in any way. China has strongly opposed the possible deployment, claiming THAAD's radar could be used against it. Ernest also said China using its influence on North Korea to get them to end their provocations is not something that they do as a favor to the United States. He said it is not in China's interest to have provocations and instability on their own doorstep. The UN Commission for the Asia-Pacific region recently held a panel session in the western port city of Incheon to discuss how Korea can overcome its labor market troubles and boost productivity. Oh Se-young reports.
Koreans are some of the most overworked employees in the world, as well as some of the most underpaid, according to the OECD. Its report suggests this may be why the country has such low productivity, especially in the service sector, which has the lowest productivity among OECD countries. Manufacturing productivity has slowed, its index hitting 99.4% last year, down by almost 3 points from 2011. Korea's productivity decline comes as part of a regional trend. On Friday, the UN's Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific launched its flagship report. It shows a collective fall in annual productivity growth to below 1% in recent years. This drop accounted for almost a fifth of the region's economic slowdown in the last decade. To revive economic growth, the report prescribed policy recommendations, primarily on boosting domestic consumption and real income by improving labor productivity.
You need to develop capacity, you need to develop workforce that is able to cope with the new challenges in the society, and then you need to increase the ability of the countries to cope with the problems that it has.
To discuss the applicability of these measures in Korea, a panel discussion was held in Incheon.
In order to boost domestic consumption, I think there's a lot of things that the government is trying to do, but because companies are not able to or not willing to invest in their reinvestment, growing their companies, hiring more people, it has created a lull in the economy, and we really need a very innovative, creative break in order to break out of this lull.
Experts also address the need to balance out uneven concentrations of wage and human capital, riddling the labor market.
Young workers avoid jobs in currently unproductive industries like service and manufacturing and turn to established conglomerates due to huge wage discrepancies. We need to foster work environments that properly compensate workers and allow them to grow.
The UN Commission says high productivity goes beyond economic gain to benefit society as a whole. It serves as a positive step towards achieving the UN Sustainable Development Goals by the year 2030. Oh Se-young, Arirang News.
The U.S. Treasury Department has put South Korea on its monitoring list for foreign exchange policies, but stopped short of designating the country as a currency manipulator. In a report released Friday local time, the department said that during the second half of 2015 through March this year, Korean authorities intervened to resist depreciation of the won during periods of financial market turbulence. It urged South Korea to limit its interventions only to circumstances of disorderly market conditions and to increase the transparency of its foreign exchange operations. China, Japan, Taiwan and Germany were also placed on the department's monitoring list for their respective foreign exchange policies. More Japanese and Chinese tourists are expected to come to Korea this week as both countries have extended public holidays. Officials say China has a 3-day weekend thanks to Labor Day celebrations. Japan is currently on its 10-day-long Golden Week holiday to prepare for the uptick in tourists from those countries. Korea's main gateway, Incheon International Airport, has increased the number of immigration counters to shorten waiting times and open check-in counters 30 minutes earlier than normal. Also, more staff have been brought in to duty-free stores, and there'll be more people helping out tourists while they're here. Last year, 100,000 Chinese tourists visited Korea during the Labor Day public holiday. 73,000 Japanese tourists came during the Golden Week. Now, virtual reality has gone beyond gaming and is now being used in many industries in various capacities, from architecture to tourism. More uses of technology are surfacing. Park Se-young has the details.
In this virtual reality tour program, tourists step off the plane, arrive at a hotel, and experience scuba diving among the coral reefs. This virtual reality architecture demo allows us to explore every corner of this realistic home, open its doors, and even turn on the lights. According to experts, virtual reality is expected to transform the way architects work. More industries in Korea are working to integrate virtual reality into their businesses. By wearing VR glasses, one can instantly travel to an overseas warehouse. People can not only check stock levels at remote facilities, but will be able to conduct meetings in virtual space, overcoming the limits of space and time. The Ministry of Science, ICT and Future Planning predicts a global VR market to grow from an estimated $4 billion this year to $50 billion in 2020. Korea has earmarked $155 million in state funds over the next 3 years to support the development of its own VR industry. Park Se-young, Arirang News.
Now, before we go, we're going to leave you with a brief look at the weather here in Korea. And most of the country is under partly cloudy skies this evening. We're going to see the overnight low dip to 12 degrees Celsius tonight. Sunday will be warm and sunny, with the highs in most parts of the country topping out in the mid to high 20s nationwide. With that, let's take a look at the weather around the world. Well, that's all we have for now. Do enjoy the rest of your Saturday wherever you're watching us, and stay tuned to Arirang TV. We'll be back with our next newscast. It's coming up at 10 p.m. Korea time. So until then, goodbye.